big of stars.
Sorry, J9. Sorry.
I'm living and I'm making. I'm living and I'm making.
What's up, everybody? It's the Alex Leek and Friends NBA Podcast, Episode 1. I'm your host, Alex Leek, and I got Aaron with me.
What's going on, Alex? I'm so glad that we're actually doing this.
We're
now
finally doing the NBA Pod. It took forever to do this, but
yeah, it had to happen. It had to happen. And I mean, today is kind of the perfect day for it.
It really is. There's so much going on, man. So much.
Right. I mean, we've got trade deadlines, All-Star Weekend, all sorts of stuff. The East is getting interesting.
Got trade demands, all kinds of stuff.
It is crazy, Alex. I'm excited.
All right, let's get right into this this Anthony Davis conundrum. He pretty much says he wants out of New Orleans. LA is all about getting Anthony Davis, getting the unibrow. First of all, Aaron, the Pelicans have pretty much said they want like 4 first round picks and more. They want to be pretty much overcompensated for sending him to LA. Is Anthony Davis worth what the Pelicans want, or worth what the Lakers are going to have to give up to get him?
Well, here's the thing. I was reading an interesting article today, and they were talking about, because the last offer that the Lakers shot towards the Pelicans,
it was ridiculous.
It was on Tuesday, and it was Brandon Ingram, Kyle Kuzma, Lonzo Ball, and now they've even added Josh Hart and Zubac, who I think is a great young talent. But, like, that's the thing. I don't think the Pelicans think that's enough. And do I believe it's enough? I mean, Kuzma and Ingram are interesting. Zubac might be good, but I don't think they want – I don't think they think that's enough. And I think they think Boston could make a better deal for them. And I wouldn't blame them.
Are there picks in that as well?
I do not – oh, you know what? I'm so sorry. And – 2 first-round picks with that.
Yeah. See, that's the thing. The picks really get me because, like, say you can get Anthony Davis to go with LeBron. Who else are you going to have on that team? If you get rid of Lonzo, Ingram, Kuzma, Josh Hart, maybe Zubac, and some first-round picks, you're going to have LeBron, Anthony Davis, and no picks. And, I mean, how are you going to build around that?
I mean, who else does that leave on the team? I mean, who do you have? You have Rondo.
Rondo, JaVale McGee.
Contavious Caldwell-Pope.
Yeah.
Those are decent guys. Oh, and you know what? They did just add, which makes me kind of upset, that the Pistons.
Reggie.
Like, kind of right there in the middle. Yeah, we got to give up Reggie Bullock, probably like our most talented young shooter.
Yeah.
The guy's knocked down. And he's a big guy.
He's a good defender, isn't he? Yeah.
Yeah. So they still have him, Tyson Chandler, JaVale McGee. I don't know why they don't try to stick JaVale McGee in there.
Yeah.
Because it's my opinion. I just kind of like, because if you're getting Anthony Davis, I mean, he'd be a good backup for him. But, like, I feel like.
And you got Tyson Chandler, too.
Yeah, you have Tyson Chandler in there. So why try to keep him?
Yeah. I would easily put McGee in there or Tyson. You don't need.
Yeah.
I mean, if they get rid of Zubac, that's one center gone. But I would rather keep, to me, I'd rather keep the young guys. You see LeBron is aging and getting older. If you have all old guys on that team, I mean, I just don't see what the Lakers are going for here. I really don't.
I think that would backfire.
Yeah.
Pretty big. That'd be like one of those teams that gets that. Because you'd have those guys and a couple of those other guys. But I think that'd be the same problem. We're not going to have Jalen. But at the same point, to beat Golden State, or even now the Bucks, Philly, anybody. I mean, you have to have a super team. You have to go for him.
Well,
I think you can't not go for him.
I get you have to go for Anthony Davis. I get that, but I just feel like that's too much to give up. And they've got a good young core. In my opinion, I really like Lonzo for his future. He reminds me. I don't know. I know LaVar Ball is tough to deal with, and as long as he stays quiet, that's good. But I like Lonzo's talent. I think that his... See, the thing that always can improve is shooting. That's, you see guys like Jimmy Butler who come in this league who have no jumper whatsoever. Jason Kidd, who's a good comparison to Lonzo. You can't tell me Lonzo's not one of the best passers you've seen.
Jason Kidd's a good comparison.
I honestly do. I think Lonzo is a year two Jason Kidd. I really do.
Oh my gosh. Okay, first off, he didn't win the rookie of the year. I don't think very close.
Jason well, that was Kidd a good
with like a stud and like a stat packer. He's a half Jason Kidd.
Kind of, but you know what they called Jason Kidd early on? They called him No J Kidd.
Yeah, that's true. But he just filled it up. So other words, I think the big thing with Lonzo is you can just see it. The effort's not there. There's, I think he's, a lot of his past life stuff is trying to be dramatic, trying to be Showtime, mm-hmm. which works in LA as long as you're kind of winning. But if you're not and you're not getting that stuff to work, like, I mean, just as a basketball organization, you got to be like, all right, if this guy's not making that happen that much and doing this kind of stuff, I don't know. I mean, I think he's dispensable. Does anybody want to take him? I don't think so.
I don't know. I think someone will take him. I think somebody, there's teams that are desperate for a point guard. You wouldn't take Lonzo in Detroit over Reggie Jackson or Ish Smith?
To be honest, in watching some Reggie Jackson, not very good, man. I'd almost put Ish Smith in there.
I like it.
I mean, I won't get too much off on the Pistons just yet. So if I do, just cut me off at any point. Well, winning a few games, trade everybody away.
All right, tell me about this. I had this debate on Facebook last week when the Anthony Davis news came up. To me, LeBron ruins star power forwards, star big men. He ruins them. He turns them into a stretch four. He takes these guys that dominate down low and says, hey, you guys go out there and shoot threes for me all day. And I feel like he's going to do the same thing to Anthony Davis if Anthony Davis goes to the Lakers. Anthony Davis can shoot the three, but he's no Chris Bosh. He's no Kevin Love. Do you think they even work well together?
Well, here's the thing. Do you even... Okay, best and worst situations. Anthony Davis is that much of a star. He's averaging almost 30 points a game this year, like 13 rebounds, almost 3 blocks.
He's incredible.
Some steals.
Yeah.
Like, he's incredible. Like, but if you remember back in the day, Kevin Love was
a monster.
Averaging something similar in Minnesota, was like they had some people there. I mean, I think New Orleans is better than that old team, but can easily have LeBron needs the whole middle open. That's the problem. It's a problem. I think LeBron needs a star point guard.
Yeah, well,
like Kyrie worked.
Yeah, exactly.
Kyrie worked well.
And Kyrie could have worked out even better if LeBron let Kyrie run the point the way a point guard is supposed to. LeBron is obsessed with this. I need to be the point guard mentality when he's big enough to play power forward. If LeBron would go down, get in the paint, post up, and if LeBron would play out of the post more and just sit down there in the paint and do his job, he could dominate even more. And then the point guard, the guys around him could do even more.
No, but you say that. But then you look at LeBron, and he's like the best passing, one of the best passing big men of all time. At that height, he is one of the... Like, I mean, when you're getting, like, 13, 14, 15 assists, making amazing no-look passes, and doing it consistently, almost more consistent than some other aspects of your game.
Yeah. No, he's a good passer, I'll admit. But, hold on one second. Yeah, I mean, I like LeBron's passing, but he also turns the ball over a little bit too much for me, more than a lot of point guards.
Really?
Yeah, last night he had like at least 6 turnovers. And speaking of last night, I want to know what you think about this. Lakers get destroyed by Victor Oladipo-less Indiana Pacers by they were down 40 at one point, and I think they lost by 30 something. You saw one point a picture of LeBron on the far end of the bench, with 3 or 4 seats in between, and then all the rest of the young guys all huddled together. Not even the young guys. Tyson Chandler was in there. The rest of the team was all huddled together, all sitting together closely. LeBron was like 3 or 4 seats over. I feel like this trade is alienating the rest of the guys on the Lakers. It's putting LeBron with on one side and the other guys on the other. And the Lakers are at a point now where they pretty much have to go through with this trade. What if they don't go through with this trade? All people are saying that it's starting to like fizzle out. This trade might not happen.
You can't get too ahead of this. Because remember at the start of the season, everybody was saying this was Golden State. They have one argument, Kevin Durant. Everybody's saying all these rumors they're hearing.
That's true.
Here's the thing. You get blown up by 45. What would Jordan do? What did Kobe do? He didn't want to talk to anybody. Neither did Jordan. I mean, Jordan was merciless to people on this team.
He didn't sit at the end of the bench, like, quiet, though.
If you probably saw it, I bet he did.
Hell no.
Things you hear about what Jordan did to his teammates were like way worse than anything these guys did. He was a monster, man.
Yeah, but like, because he wanted to win.
He's not Mickey Mouse.
Because he wanted to win. That's the biggest difference.
LeBron, I agree.
That's a good question.
Here's the thing. He's been on such teams like in his career. Like, okay, so Miami was great. His first Cavs team was great. I mean, he won the championship with Kyrie. But then that next year, that's such a fall apart. And he put the whole team on his back. I think even at his age, man, like there's a point like you just don't – like when that bullshit comes by, you got to take some time, be by yourself. You know, it doesn't help because you know you're just going to go off on these guys because that game wasn't lost by him. I mean, you don't that's the thing. I mean, his stats weren't awful. I mean, he's still putting up, like, a ton of points, man. I mean, he's still carrying that team.
Well,
so,
when, I don't know. In my mind, I look at LeBron like this. I think that he's not all in on the Lakers. I really do. I think that he went to L.A. and with the idea of, not that there's good young talent here that I can build and develop and win with. He went to the Lakers thinking, oh, if I go to L.A., other star players will come to L.A., and that's all he ever cared about. And so LeBron is all in on this Anthony Davis guy. And I feel like he gave up too quickly on future stars, in my opinion. Alonzo's a future all-star, in my opinion. Brandon Ingram.
Are you smoking crack with that talk?
Brandon Ingram is ridiculous.
This is episode one of the
dude, I'm going at it.
Insanity. All right, guys. Next topic is Bigfoot. Is he real or is he definitely real?
Well, I'm higher on Ingram, Kuzma, and Lonzo than a lot of people are.
Kuzma, great. I think Ingram's going to be pretty good. I think he still has some stuff to iron out. He's going to be good. But I think Kuzma could be very good.
So,
he could be a very good scorer. I mean, I think he could be like a Tobias Harris. Kind of just always come up and just like, boom, tons of points right there. I mean, any situation. That could just make him have just like a long career no matter what. Just being able to score like that in bunches.
I agree. And speaking of going in that direction with Tobias Harris, the Clippers moved Tobias Harris, Boban, and Mike Scott to the Sixers for Wilson Chandler, Mike Muscala, and two firsts. The Clippers seem to be acquiring draft picks and stuff like this. I think the Clippers are trying to make a move for Anthony Davis this offseason as well. I think a bunch of teams are hoping that Anthony Davis doesn't get traded now and gets moved in the offseason.
But you think that'd be such a bad move by New Orleans? The only way, I mean, they still have good guys on that team, don't get me wrong. I mean, they still have Drew Holiday, who they're paying a lot of money. Let's think, who else? Mirotić has been lighting it up down there. Markieff Morris is good. Okafor's been kind of coming into his own a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
They have some decent people, but that is a small market team. If they don't make a trade right now, they will fall out of...
Well,
they're gonna be you could just easily be the Buffalo Bills. Boom.
Yeah.
Overnight.
Part of the guy that's trying to encourage the Pelicans to wait is Celtics GM Danny Ainge, who is hoping, he's determined to try to pair up Anthony Davis with Kyrie Irving long term. Do you think that would be a good fit in Boston?
Oh yeah, that'd be perfect. Because like you were saying, LeBron and Anthony Davis take up similar space.
Yes.
Now with Kyrie and him, and I think Kyrie wants to win that. And if you were the Pelicans, I think you would have to look at that as your most, the most beneficial for yourself trade.
Yeah.
You could get a lot of those young guys. I mean, there's a lot of possibilities there. How that'll mess up the Celtic dynamic, I don't know. Because if you look at the Celtics lately, man, they have been clobbering people.
Really?
Just as they are.
Yeah.
I think their last loss was to the Warriors by 4.
Wow.
And then in that time, they beat the Thunder.
Oh, yeah. I watched that Celtics-Warriors. I called it a finals preview.
Yeah. That was great.
Yeah.
That was very good. So almost with the Celtics, man, I'd be nervous making a lot of, like, moves.
Yeah.
But at the same point, I think they could still have – they could give up enough. And don't they still have draft picks?
Yeah.
I really think they have some big draft picks still coming up because they had some – man, they had some amazing draft stock for like a bit.
Yeah, and that's the thing is I agree with you. Ideally, you would like to keep the Celtics as is, but the Warriors are so good that it changes everything. Like, you have to load up in order to beat the Warriors. Go ahead.
And just going back to Anthony Davis, I mean, just look at his stats. Look what he does on the floor. Like, look at his plus-minus percentage.
Yeah.
Almost even outside of like LeBron, but even I think he's with years to come probably one of the most desirable players that you're gonna want.
Yeah.
I mean, Kevin Durant, he's gonna make a splash, a big splash. But besides that, Anthony Davis just has such an uptick too, just with how good he's been playing.
Now, speaking of that, Kyrie Irving, back in October, he said, "I want to re-sign here in Boston." He was asked recently if he still has that mindset, and he said, quote, "Ask me July 1. So maybe Kyrie, changing his tune a little bit, he also reached out to LeBron and was like, I didn't realize how hard it was to lead a team. So maybe Kyrie could be something to look for to go out to L.A. and rejoin LeBron if he wants out of Boston.
No, I don't think. Here's the thing. I think Kyrie likes to talk.
Yeah.
He's been in a movie, Uncle Drew. he loves the light, man. I think he likes to stir things up. Because even with that whole flat earth thing he was saying, I saw him in an interview after. He's like, I just kind of said that just to rile people up.
Yeah.
He just kept saying, but what if? But what if? I think he just likes to do that. Like, he gets so – just imagine being pestered all the time, especially by the Boston media.
Yeah.
Like – like, I hear they're pretty ruthless. you just have to after a bit, especially being him, just having some young have an attitude, you just say stuff, you know?
Yep. Well,
you just stop answering the questions.
Yeah, in my opinion, what are you doing, Kyrie? You got a great fit in Boston. You got a great head coach. You got great surrounding talent. Why would you want to leave that? You're in a great market.
No. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. No, it doesn't make any sense, especially with that. I mean, top-down, that is a good organization to be with. You're in Boston.
Danny Ainge, of all people, man. Danny Ainge is a winner.
Huge fan base, man. Brad Stevens, super young, but a super talented coach.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's the place you want to be. Like that, and that's where, like, I think you get star power. Because you even look at, like, Philly, like, are we talking about Tobias Harris trade?
Yeah, let's get to that. The Clippers... trading Tobias Harris.
Yep.
Philly. Let's talk about Philly adding Tobias Harris. I mean, now you're talking about Ben Simmons, Joel Embiid, Jimmy Butler, and now Tobias Harris. That's an impressive lineup.
No, that's a super impressive lineup. And sorry for the terrible segue into it.
No, you're good.
We're going to talk about Tobias Harris.
quick question. Do you regret Tobias Harris leaving Detroit? Being traded?
Yes, yeah. I really do.
Yeah.
Because I think with Detroit, especially Detroit, now looking at that, we got Blake, he's playing out of his mind, but we're missing players. And that's the thing. We don't have power to pull those good players. So if you get good players like that, like star players, I mean, he was forgive me if I'm wrong, but he was an all-star a couple of years ago, correct?
I think so. He's a damn good player. It's underrated as hell.
Yeah, he's averaged like 23 points a game. I think like, what is it? Yeah, 8 assists. 20.9 points per game. 8 rebounds. 3 assists.
Okay.
But
those rebounds are good.
Yeah. He's only 26. He's not old. Yeah, you could have really – I liked him in Avery Bradley beyond the distance. But Philly, that's the move. I mean, he's streaking up. He's got a relatively small – he's 14.8 for that talent is great.
Yeah.
When you're paying J.J. Redick, what? I think they're only paying him – they're only paying him 12 this year, but I swear he re-signed and his contract is structured for like $25 million.
Yeah.
In one of those years. He's making some money coming soon, so that's great money for him. But the Sixers, man, that is every single person on that starting roster has been an all-star recently.
Yeah, and
that's crazy.
You know that team could get pretty good defensively with Jimmy Butler, Joel Embiid in the middle. They got suit length, man. Ben Simmons has incredible length now. Tobias Harris, man, they're gonna be fun to watch in that Eastern Conference.
Super fun in Alex. And you can't forget on the 76ers, now they've got Boban. And if you're a 76ers fan, that's awesome.
He's not a bad backup center, though.
No, dude, he has points. When he's in, he just gets an offensive rebound. He's going right back in.
Yeah.
He's good. He's going to give him 20 minutes a game, and he's going to pad the stats. And, I mean, everybody loves him when he comes in, man.
He's got a good following.
Yeah, I just went to that Clippers versus Pistons game, and people were standing up, giving him an ovation.
Wow.
He played for the Pistons for like a year.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Just getting love like that.
Speaking of, where do you want to go play? The Ball patriarch, LeVar Ball, tells ESPN that if Lonzo Ball is traded, he wants his son to go to Phoenix. Quote, "We want to be in LA, but if he's traded, I don't want him in New Orleans. Phoenix is the best fit for him." What do you make of LeVar Ball's comments here? He's been kind of quiet, but here he comes talking again, trying to control the narrative.
Well, if I was his 21-year-old son,
yeah,
making millions of dollars,
yep,
you know, granted some of it may be related to him with his big, I don't know, just because of branding and stuff, but like, why are you letting him talk for you?
Exactly.
He's been in the WWE recently. He's all over interviews. He's literally just a tabloid of a person. He's just an explosion out of a tabloid. Just the worst things about it. That's the thing. If he messes up his son's career by, like, even just making that kind of, like, toxic environment.
Dude, he easily could. He really could. See, this is what I've been saying. This is how high I am on Lonzo. I've been saying Lonzo's going to be a star in this league in spite of his father. I said at some point, Lonzo's game is going to outgrow his father's talk. And that's what's going to have to happen. I agree with you 100%. Lonzo needs to sit down and be like, look, thanks for all your help, LeVar, but let me speak for myself. This is my career.
All right. Alex, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
So what part of averaging 9 points, 5 rebounds, and 5 assists to you is all-star?
Well, he's young. I know that he's shooting bad free throws. But the eye test to me tells it all. I think that he's more athletic than people give him credit for. You see some of the dunks that he throws down are pretty impressive for a point guard. He's a big point guard.
True, but some of the worst guys in the league are the most athletic.
True, but he's young.
A lot of guys on that bench, have some lankiness, speed.
He's very young. The shot will come, I think. I think the shot will get fixed. And I think that he has rare vision. I think that he has potential to be one of the best passers the game has ever seen.
Alex. Blow up a little bit when you say all this stuff? or is this palatable?
Speaking of point guards, tough news for the Washington Wizards as their star point guard John Wall slips and falls in his home, rupturing his Achilles tendon, and will be out about a year. Tough blow for the Wizards.
Yeah, man. And if I was a fan of that team, which I'm a fan of the Pistons, yeah, so it's about the same. But, man, DC has just been really like, any point they've looked up about, they just immediately just, no.
Yeah.
Guys get traded away. John Wall's always injured. You just see Trevor Ariza back in the lineup here and there.
Yeah.
Just like a ghost. Why is he back in the lineup? He's been traded away and back like four times now.
I heard the Lakers are trying to get Ariza back.
Yeah, they should. He's a good player. He's the guy who, you know, gets like Lonzo Ball stats. Except he plays a little bit of math, just barely anymore.
As a fan that has been through this before, when Carlos Boozer tripped over his bag and messed his leg up, I believe, it hurts incredibly for one of your best players to get hurt, slip and fall at home, or have something happen at home where you miss significant time. I feel for Washington fans here because, I mean, I've been there before. It sucks.
Yeah, man. I mean, it's a big market. They've had good success there. They put together a good team. Him, Beal, Porter, some of those other guys. I'm always forget his name. Eastern European guy. Mohawk.
Gortat.
Gortat, dude. What a player. Loved that team when that team was together.
Yeah.
That was going to be a playoff run team, but never made it far. Maybe second round. That was as far as they'd ever make it.
And they should have made it more. I think they did make the conference finals against Boston 1 year and couldn't get past Boston in seven.
Okay.
But okay. I think anyways, I could be wrong, but you're gonna have to be patient with me. I've been so focused on NFL that my NBA is slacking a little bit, but I'm gonna catch up. If we're doing this every week, we're gonna get better at it.
We will be. And it's nice going to, you know, a league where they score points. not like the worst Super Bowl I've ever seen in my entire life.
Oh, but man. I was so happy. 3-0 at halftime. I was like, this is football right here.
Oh, my gosh. And then did Maroon 5 come out and you're like, this is football?
No. I changed the channel at halftime. I told Andrew Price, I was telling him this on Facebook. I said, I loathe the halftime or the Super Bowl. If I wanted to watch a has-been artist perform a concert, I'd go to one.
Yeah. You know, why is this? And now compared to the NBA, why is the NFL always so just bonded up in so much just controversy all the time? Always something with their public image. Always is mess. Just something is going viral for some reason. What makes the NBA almost... I wouldn't say like immune, but what have they done to stay at, like, I don't know, just stay out of that?
Well, they're much better ran. I mean, this new commissioner, Adam Silver, I feel like he's a home run hire. He's done a lot of good. He's socially aware. He's up to date on, you know, all that. He's not, you know, the NFL is old school. The NFL, like LeBron mentioned, and I don't really disagree with him. The NFL is like, you do what we tell you to do. The owners control everything. The players are just robots or puppets, pretty much, in the NFL. And in the NBA, the players have so much more power. And
They're dispensable. Their contracts are terrible, the way they're structured.
Yeah.
But
I'll say this. I think the NFL does a better job with parity. I think that the NBA... With the players determining where they're going to go now all the times, it's making for some really weird... You got so many teams rebuilding, and... But anyways...
Constantly. You're either rebuilding now,
yeah,
or you're going for a championship.
Yeah, that's it. There's no middle ground.
Yep, like you're saying, like the Clippers. The Clippers are in 8th place or 7th place right now, a 30-25 record.
Yeah.
Yet they've just thrown away their year.
Yeah. I mean, it's weird, but...
It's weird for a team to be in the middle like that.
Yeah, just like tear it all down.
Yep.
Let's get to your team real quick. We haven't talked much about the Pistons. They also traded Stanley Johnson to the Bucks for Thon Maker. You mentioned moving Reggie Bullock for that, for us. V, I believe he is. He's a 3-point shooter. I didn't really know him that well, but Justin Peake informed me on whose V was. What do you make of the Pistons' moves and their future this year? Do you think the Pistons are currently third in the Central, sitting at 24-29? I'm sure you had higher expectations for this team. Do you think these trades help that out?
Possibly. possibly, it's hard to see. I mean, I think the Stanley Johnson trade was good.
Yeah.
He was averaging his career, and it wasn't going anywhere. Like, it was 7 points a game, like 7.9 points a game, 4 or 5 rebounds. Nothing really what we thought he was going to be. We thought he was going to be a Jimmy Butler, lockdown defender, grow him offensively, because he would have bouts of it. I mean, you'd hear from Andre Drummond, Reggie Jackson. Hey, when he's on, he's on.
Yeah.
You know, he looks like a scary 6'6", 6'7" player with some weight on him that can guard the heck out of anybody. But at the same end, if he's scoring, I mean, he's great.
I don't know the exact dynamics with Stanley Johnson. I liked him coming out of college. And he reminds me, it's a good comparison to Jimmy Butler, because I think you have to have a lot of patience with guys like him. If the Bulls didn't have patience with Jimmy Butler, they would have moved on from him when he was shooting 2 for 20 in the playoffs. And, you know, he's a hell of a defender, but he can't hit the broadside of a barn jump shot-wise. Now look at Jimmy Butler.
Yeah, so, that's true. I mean, guys are not being given the time to develop. But at the same point, there's the pool is that thick. There's that many guys that are good.
Yeah.
That you could just move in. So, I mean, as an establishment, you're looking to make money. You got to look at your fiscal year. I mean, that's the thing now. I mean, it's high scoring, fast moving. There's not much brand loyalty in the NBA. Because I even heard of Toronto talking about doing some more trades that really surprised you.
Yeah.
But, getting back to the Pistons really quick, it's interesting. You got to get Reggie Jackson.
Yeah.
That contract is not turning out. Besides that, Blake Griffin's playing out of his mind.
I posted this on Facebook a little bit back. The Grizzlies are now shopping Mark Gasol and Mike Conley. That's a huge upgrade at that position if the Pistons were to make a move for and get Mike Conley.
Man, will they pay that contract, though?
I don't know.
I feel maybe they'd switch us for Reggie.
Yeah, but...
Reggie and somebody.
You got to throw in some other pieces. That straight up's not going to go.
Yeah. I mean, people have done worse.
Someone tweeted tonight, they said Mike Conley joins the Pistons tomorrow. He believed that he would lead them to the playoffs.
Yeah, very well could.
Do you think...
But at the same time, why would you give up Reggie Bullock? I know he's a piece.
That is a little surprising to me.
Yeah, but for nothing.
Yeah.
I think we got some draft picks next year, which, okay, great, but they're second round. Nothing against second rounds. But I don't know.
It's just very... It's forward... It makes you think forward-thinking. I thought we... Because besides that... Blake Griffin is the big contract at 32.
Yeah.
Then you've got Andre at 25. Two great contracts. Nothing wrong with those. You got to pay both those guys that money. Andre Drummond's having a great year. But then there's Reggie. Besides that, you don't really have any big... Next is John Luer.
Yeah,
wow. 10 mil. So you had space. I mean, why aren't... It's hard to say throw a hat in the ring with, you know, for all the other big guys, but why aren't you trying?
Well, exactly. And my point is this. You look at... Where Blake Griffin had success before with the Clippers, why not follow their model? They had a big rim protector presence that could block shots and rebound and DeAndre Jordan, and the Pistons have something similar in Andre Drummond.
Yeah.
Then you throw Blake Griffin in there, you know what's missing? A point guard to run the offense, and that's what I would do if I was Detroit. Speaking of that, let's look at the Eastern Conference. Who, you know, you got Toronto, Boston, Philly, all in the Atlantic, dueling it out. You got the Bucks leading the Central. The Southeast is a little weak, but I'm a Hornets fan. I'm a Bulls fan, but I like the Hornets. I like Miles Bridges a lot.
Yeah, I like them too.
Who do you think comes out of the East? Who do you think can get to the NBA Finals this year? Is Boston are they the path?
You know what? I would say that. But with all this trade talk, and they're just getting... I mean, they are playing very good right now.
Yeah.
I think they have won the last 9 out of 10 games. But you know who else has? The Bucks.
Wow.
And the Bucks are 40-13, best team in the league. The Milwaukee Bucks are the best team.
in the entire league.
Damn,
right now.
I didn't notice that. That's pretty impressive.
Yeah, that is. It's insane because I've heard them say it a couple times, and I know they've been really good. But like the last few times they said, I'm like, wait, I had to double check because that is an intense team. I really think, you know what, the Bucks are rolling. I just saw them destroy. I mean, even though it's John Willis, Washington, by 148. I mean, with 148 points, they are the second in the league in points per game.
Wow.
First in rebounds, fifth in assists. I mean, you know, if you're in the top of all those categories, you're going to win. I don't see any reason to bet against them right now with Boston. I think they would terrorize Boston.
So if you're picking a team to represent the Eastern Conference today, are you taking the Bucks? I know you're big on Giannis, and I know you like Malcolm Brogdon as well.
Yeah. No, you just look at that roster, and there's some teams, you know, they got star power, like Philly, star power, even Boston.
Yeah.
They've got a lot of glue, but a lot of star power and trying to get more. Toronto's pretty good, but I'm still saying Toronto's going to lose it.
Yeah.
Always like Toronto does. They're going to do the same thing. dude, the Bucks, when you watch that team, there is something about them. Just the way they pass. I think they had 50 assists tonight in the game.
Wow.
50 assists, that's crazy. They share so well. Eric Bledsoe's playing well. Brogdon's playing great. Nobody really knows who Brogdon is, I don't think, that much. But he's a great player. George Hill joined that team not long ago. Tony Snell's still there. I mean, they got good guys.
Yeah.
I think the way they play right now is different. And you put Giannis up against that Boston team, who's guarding him?
I'm putting Giannis, let's see, I think it's got to be like Tatum and Hayward.
Is that who? Guarding Giannis?
Yeah, or Morris.
Oh, man, I mean, he's 6'11 with like, what, 7'6 wingspan?
I mean, who do you put on, Al Horford? Like, he's a nightmare matchup, he really is.
Yeah, and I just watched him on a fast break pick up the ball well above the three line, and in two or three steps, he was dunking it.
Yeah.
Like, what do you do on the fast break? And they're such a fast team, too. I think the Bucks are playing different enough from everybody else that nobody can match what they're doing. If they start playing Milwaukee basketball, you can't beat them in the East.
I think you could put Tatum on. I think Marcus Morris is probably your best defender for Giannis. But, I mean, I could see the foul trouble getting up with him and...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's a nightmare matchup for anybody. So if you were picking right now, you would say the Bucks to represent the East?
I think so, Alex. I'm going Bucks, man. They haven't been playing wrong. They're playing great. You can't hate great.
I'm a prove it to me guy. I like regular season success is all fine and dandy, but I want to see you do it when it matters most. And the Bucks need to prove it to me that they can get past the Celtics, which they couldn't do last year. And this Sixers team with that roster right now, I'm picking Philly to represent the East. I wasn't before. I would have said Boston, but the acquisition of Tobias Harris, in my mind, puts them like winning Game 7 against the Celtics in the ECF.
True. I mean, that's the thing. That Philly team is super scary.
Yeah.
But, man, there's just something. It's like when you already have a team playing and has a better record than anybody in the league.
Oh, yeah.
What are you going to say?
And like I said, Giannis is going to be tough for anyone to stop, especially playoff time. Giannis is going to have to, like, go LeBron James Cleveland mode and destroy.
But he has been. He had a quote the other week that was somebody asked him, well, are you afraid of these teams making these trades and acquisition? He's like, hey, you know what? Right now, we are the best in the league. We are playing the best in many positions and stats. Everybody else has to catch up.
Yeah.
You know, why are we worried? Why should you be worried in the front?
I like it.
I mean,
I like the mindset these young guys are coming in with. I like Embiid's mindset, too. He's got old school, like, I'm not going to help you up after I dunk on you type. He's got that fire that a lot of NBA players nowadays lack.
And just with how advanced the NBA's gotten, how they help out their rookies now, they know the stumbling blocks. These young guys, man, are smart.
Yeah.
I mean, they're coming out, they know how to work their money. I mean, just remember all the guys in the past that had just money problems.
Yeah.
Like, you know, as soon as they're on the NBA, they're done. So they're handling themselves better. Their fitness is better. It's a different. I mean, you're going to see Adam Nkumbos all over the place.
I disagree.
I think 10 years, you're going to have a lot of those hybrid.
People are not just birthing out Giannis. Nobody's giving birth to Giannis these days. Like, there'll be more. I do agree that players are getting better with ball handling and better shooters and all that. But I like the old school guys like Embiid that bring the toughness and, you know, I don't know. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. Just seeing how it is. I mean, it's the craziest year. When do you think the last time the NBA has changed? Like, I think it did this little bit last year and this year.
Oh, it did. It really turned the landscape. Like, the East opened wide up because who knows who's going to come out of the East, which is fun. It's going to make the Eastern playoffs a lot of fun. And now the West is competitive, too. Let's talk about the West. I mean, the Nuggets are leading their division. OKC close behind. Then you got Portland and Utah all above 500. The Warriors are great again. The Clippers are decent. The Lakers are 500. The Rockets are good. The Spurs are good. Who do you think comes out of the West? I mean, the Warriors are obviously the team to beat. Do you think anyone can challenge them? Like Houston did last year, up 3-2?
You know what? Houston just made a pretty interesting trade as well. Houston, once they get, if Chris Paul stays healthy.
Yeah.
Okay. That I think they're always up in the air. If you've got a guy like Harden playing like as he does and can consistently do this, and then he gets Capella back. Let's see. I'm so sorry. Let me pull up this.
do it.
I think. Oh, they just got Nick Stauskas and Iman Shumpert.
Yeah. Stauskas is a shooter. Shumpert, he can play some defense.
I think Shumpert will be great. He was a good setup three shooter.
Yeah, he can hit the open three.
Stauskas can play well. I think those guys are going to play right into that system. They have done a good job developing guys. Houston could. I think Houston could. I don't think they will. I think OKC could.
Yes.
I think that's where I'd go.
You know, OKC has surprised me. Paul George is balling this year, and I didn't see that coming. I remember a couple years ago, I think it was 2 years ago when the Pacers were playing it was 2 years ago, the Pacers were playing the Cavs. It was the 1-8 seed in the Eastern Conference playoffs, and they got swept, and Paul George looked awful. He couldn't hit a big shot. You know, the Cavs just ran over him. And I think Paul George has really improved. He's having a hell of a year. And he's a good compliment for Westbrook.
Oh, he's insane right now. I mean, 28 points a game, 8 rebounds, 4 assists. It's crazy knowing his leg injury.
Yeah.
That he has not only come back, not just like Grant Hill and some of these guys had a good career, made an All-Star once. He is dominant.
I'm so happy for him. I saw that injury live and I was sick. I was sick to my stomach. Yeah. That was disgusting.
Oh, terrible. And then it was in the off season.
Yeah.
Playing the Olympics, which is always, I mean, great they played, but ugh.
Yeah.
Not the place you want to do it for. But yeah, now they're playing great. And now that Westbrook had his slump of shooting, pretty rough stretch there. He was not shooting well, not shooting the best free throws, but is still averaging a triple-double. Not only a triple-double, 21, 11, and 11. It's like, you know, he can play worse and still average a triple-double.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
And he's had a shooting slump this year.
Yeah.
Which is insane. I always feel like Russell Westbrook, just when you look at his stats and your jaw drops, you're like, why are we focusing so much on some other guys sometimes?
I remember when
this guy is insane.
I remember when LeBron was first early years in Cleveland and he referenced how Oscar Robertson was the last guy to average a triple-double in a season, and he wanted to. And there was a thought that maybe LeBron could do it if he wanted to. It's amazing to me that Westbrook has the potential to average a triple-double for the third year in a row. That's incredible. He's insane. And
did he do it the last 2 years? I thought he just did it last year.
I gotta pull it up. I think he did it 2 years in a row. No, if he did it last year, he's done it 2 years in a row. Pull up the stats.
You know what? You're right, man.
That's incredible.
Insane.
I know.
And the year before, he missed it by 2 rebounds.
Yeah.
A game.
And because I was talking with somebody, and I was like, wait, is that true? Did he do it 2 years in a row? It's insane. Yeah. So you got OKC, Houston.
OKC, Houston could challenge it, but if you've watched the Golden State Warriors lately.
Oh, my God. Boogie adds a whole nother level.
He was playing great.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't think that he would gel as well as he has. He's come in and fit right in, and he's dunking on people, grabbing boards. He's a way more talented and brings that toughness that Kendrick Perkins used to bring to the Celtics.
Oh, and you know what? I think that's perfect because that gets Draymond all off the hook of
exactly.
being the bad guy, and it kind of just makes the whole team the bad guy.
Can you imagine, like, you try to start a fight with the Warriors, you used to have Draymond to deal with, now you got Boogie Cousins as well? Like, that's intimidating.
Oh, you know, 1 second earlier, there was JaVale McGee coming at you. Back, it's DeMarcus Cousins now.
Yeah.
Insane. That's the thing. He's, like, dunking on people, shoving people.
Yeah.
I mean, they just beat... They beat the Spurs by 39 points tonight.
Wow.
Decent Spurs.
Yeah, the Spurs are still competitive.
Out of their mind, man. That's the thing. Put this team against the Bucks. I think the Bucks is the only team that can give them problems.
All right. Warriors-Bucks would be a hell of a finals. I'd sign up to watch that. I'm picking Warriors-Sixers, and I think that Embiid versus Cousins... And Butler, man, you're looking for some drama. You're looking for, like, some fights in those finals.
Yeah. Oh, dude, I saw when Golden State played 76ers just a little bit ago.
Yeah.
Embiid thinks he can get in people.
I know, I love
it. His cousin comes out, and I think almost scares him. Like, comes out, throws the ball at him, and he just, like, looks at him, and almost, like, kind of backs down. You're like, oh, my gosh, he's afraid.
Dude,
DeMarcus Cousins.
Cousins is like a football player in a basketball guy body. Like, he's crazy.
Oh, yeah, man. He's kind of got that Tom Brundage rundown run the floor now. Just super inside reference there.
He's got that Mike Shea run the floor crazy.
Yeah, he's getting back in shape. But he's only 28. He should be able to come back. You know?
Yeah. No, I expect him to. He's a hell of an athlete.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he's putting up stats, but he can just do exactly what he wants to do now because you have five All-Stars.
Oh, man, you can't double anybody.
No.
It's crazy.
And he's hitting a three.
Yeah.
That's the thing. I think right now in the NBA, man, with some of these super teams, you know, and, I mean, Philly and just – but there's just so much good talent because just think – like, we were just going over the standings. East is great, but, like, the West is so stacked, too, top to bottom.
Yeah.
The Clippers was a good team. Jazz are a great team.
Yeah. Joe Ingles, baby.
Yeah. And then you look at the teams that aren't.
Donovan Mitchell.
Yeah. The Dallas Mavericks had it streaky. LA's not even in there yet. Sacramento's good.
Dallas is right there, and they got the young rookie Luka, and now you add Porzingis. I mean, Porzingis probably won't play this year.
No.
But looking forward, Dallas could be something to mess with. I mean.
Oh, yeah, man. Dallas is going to be great.
Isn't Mark Cuban a hell of an owner? He always stays aggressive.
Great, man. I mean, just watching stuff on him and what he did for that team. He got him a private jet. He's the one who started. Just think, that wasn't even that long ago. But before that, they used to fly a lot of commercial, first class stuff. But
wow.
He was one of the first guys started getting jets, redid the locker room, his cool locker rooms.
Yeah.
Like, made it a place people wanted to come.
Absolutely. Dallas was not a destination before Cuban got there.
Yep, and he is always working. I mean, even the roster this last year, and this year, I was like, that's not a bad roster. They've got sneaky good guys.
Yep. And I really appreciate Mark Cuban's loyalty to Dirk. And Dirk is so old now, and he's a shell of his former self, but he keeps paying him, keeps letting him play. He's like a coach player. And he said that when Dirk retires and he wants a job on the team, he's like, anything he wants, he's earned it. That's damn cool.
That is sweet. He is a pretty loyal guy, and he's just a smart guy, and I think he's involved. Because look at this. Look at Dallas' roster right now, and granted, they're probably going to trade a lot of these guys, draft these guys. But even right now, they got Barea, Harrison Barnes, Trey Burke from Michigan, who could play decent, Donick, Tim Hardaway Jr., Devin Harris, Courtney Lee,
Dirk, obviously, Porzingis, Dwight Powell, all those guys, some of the smaller guys, are sneaky kind of good. And, like, they're not bad people to have on your team.
Harrison Barnes is actually trending right now because he was traded mid-game today. He didn't even find out. Like, he was traded while he was playing the game to the Sacramento Kings.
And, oh, you are right.
And they get back Justin Jackson and Zach Randolph.
Zach Randolph would be like, hey, if you're going to the playoff push,
yeah,
but maybe they're just going to let him go.
Yeah, they might just let him go. Justin Jackson, I don't know how he's done in the pro game, but I remember he was good in college at UNC.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, they'll free up contract space. You know what? That's not even updated on online yet, but I did see that before. I forgot that.
Yeah.
Sacramento, man.
Making some moves.
Another team. You know what? Talking about Lonzo Ball most greatness.
Yeah.
I see all these regret articles about DeAndre Fox. Like, if the Lakers would have just drafted him.
He's balling. He's incredible.
He's great, man. He's so fast.
Yeah.
He's going to be a really good player.
Speaking of Dirk Nowitzki, let's talk about the All-Star Weekend that's coming up here soon, February 15 through 17, and not this coming weekend, but the next. Three-point contest. You want to make a prediction here? Who you got winning the three-point? We got Devin Booker from the Suns, Seth Curry from the Blazers, Steph Curry from the Warriors, Danny Green from the Raptors, Joe Harris from the Nets, Buddy Hield from the Kings, Damian Lillard from the Blazers, Chris Middleton from the Bucks, Kemba Walker from the Hornets, and Dirk Nowitzki from the Mavs. Who do you think comes out with a three-point win?
I got one question about that.
Yeah.
Why is this three-point contest so stacked this year?
I don't know. I mean,
I don't think I've heard all those sorts of names. I mean, Kemba Walker, Steph Curry.
Yeah.
You're throwing in Dirk.
Yeah.
All these guys are in there. You know, usually, I mean, what happened the days ago? We just have these, like, random guys that were just practice guys coming in, just hitting, and you're like, why are these guys playing?
But, I don't know, but I like it. I'm looking forward to it.
If you got to ask, I mean, Steph Curry, you got to say it.
You know what?
Who wants to be going up against Steph Curry in a three-point shooting contest?
Steph Curry is going to be beat this year, and it's not going to be Devin Booker. I know that's what you're thinking. It's not going to be Seth Curry. It's not going to be Buddy Hield, former Oklahoma Sooner. You know who it's going to be?
Those were none of the people I was thinking of. Clarify.
It's going to be former Michigan State Spartan Danny Green from the Raptors. Former Spur. Look up.
The three-point shooter.
The Spartans are just going to sweep these two contests on Saturday night. The slam dunk contest as well. Knicks, Dennis Smith Jr., Hornets, Miles Bridges, Thunder, Hamidou Diallo. I don't know who that is. Do you know Diallo?
I do not.
Yeah, me neither. John Collins from the Hawks. Who do you think he's a sneaky John Collins. Who do you think takes the slam dunk?
I've seen Collins dunk before.
He's pretty good.
He's pretty good.
But
once again, why is this not stat?
Exactly. The dunk contest is never stacked.
It's so weird because it's such a cool one. And I mean, if you lose, you lose. But haven't all these guys wanted to be in the dunk contest since they were kids?
Yeah. I mean,
if we could have been in the dunk contest, we definitely would have been.
Definitely. I remember when LeBron James said, hey, next year put me on there. I'm going to be in the dunk contest. And then never followed through. That is another good one.
Yeah.
You can tell I'm bitter.
I can't, Alex. You were always bitter about LeBron. Dude, I mean, that's the thing. He should have done it, but whatever.
Yeah, whatever. Miles Bridges is taking home that trophy, though. It's going to be a Spartan sweep Saturday night. Hopefully.
Yeah, so, I don't know those guys too much, but, I mean, it's going to be Steph Curry. He's going to win.
He's the best shooter. He's the best shooter of all time, really. Best three-point shooter of all time.
I mean, just look at the stats, just how he shoots, just how he practices. This is going to be this is going to be hard to practice for him. Seriously, it's going to be like a layup.
Nice.
He is going to go off. There's going to be one, he's going to stay competitive, but there's going to be like the end round when he gets warmed up. He's going to make every single shot, almost.
Well, Aaron, let's get these coming out every week. You might not be on all of them, but we're going to try and get NBA going. This is episode one. Pretty good start. Lots to talk about, huh?
I like it, man. I like it. I'm excited to see the Bucks.
Yeah, make a run, Alex, go deep in the playoffs.
Alex, I think we should lay down a bet real quick.
Okay.
Bucks or Philly, you know, if one of them makes it to the finals.
Yeah.
What kind of bet we got going here?
How about a... I'll get you a sack of sour diesel. No,
and if the Bucks win, I'm just saying, you gotta go to like a Kenny Loggins concert.
Oh my god. Okay, but if I go to a Kenny Loggins concert, I'm bringing that sack of sour diesel.
Oh, dude, Kenny wouldn't want it either way.
All right, dude. Aaron, great success on the podcast. Thanks for being on this one, the inaugural NBA podcast. Thanks, bro.
Dude, let's do this.
Let's get some interviews on this one, too. I'm excited to interview some NBA guys here soon.
Yeah, that would be great, man. I mean, Joe Dumars probably is.
Let's get Isaiah Thomas, Lambeer on the show.
Oh, great. We'll just sound like 3 Peter or something. Give me a second.
All right, bro. Thanks. Good job. Thanks, everyone, for listening. Don't forget to like, subscribe, or leave a comment. Expect more episodes of the Alex Leak and Friends NBA podcast coming soon. Thanks, everybody. Peace out.
Peace.